And if you had enough time for that, I'm delighted to introduce our next speaker, who is our chair of the webinar, Dr. Eric Deval, who is a senior cardiothoracic anesthetist at the University Medical Center at Utrecht. Eric is the current chair of the IACTA Transplant and VET subcommittee. He has major research interest in cardiovascular monitoring, goal-directed therapy, and recently in vasoplegia. Today, he is going to talk to us and review the mechanisms of primary graft dysfunction. And while we already alluded to this, this will have new information and will probably provide the answers to your polls. Eric?
Dear friends, dear colleagues, thank you very much. Probably someone should stop this unmute itself. So thank you very much for being with us during this webinar. It's beautiful weather outside, even here in the Netherlands, in the middle of the Netherlands, near Utrecht, the hospital I'm working in, University Medical Center in Utrecht. And I'm delighted to present you primary graft dysfunction after heart transplantation. So I have no conflicts of interest related to this lecture, and my talk deals with primary graft dysfunction after heart transplantation. Here you sit on both chairs, the donor and the recipient. Most often they're not so quite next to each other, but in between, well, heart transplantation is a rose for the recipient, but it goes together with a lot of issues, complications, and well, primary graft dysfunction is one of the thorns in this heart transplantation, during heart transplantation. Well, the learning objectives of this presentation is to find out what's the, to learn the definition, what's the pathophysiology, outcomes, risk factors, and what can we do about preventing this, or what is the therapy for this. Well, the reason for an international consensus definition came from research started about 15 years ago. There were 6 retrospective single or multicenter studies published dealing with 45 to less than 400 transplant patients. And primary graft dysfunction, the definitions used was low blood pressure with poor contractility or high dose of inotropics or need for mechanical circulatory support. And the incidence was reported to be between 1 and 26% with an overall mortality of 13.7% to 75%. So that brought us to another study. Russo presented this study. He took patients from the United Network for Organ Sharing, nearly 17,000 patients in the period of 2000 to 2007. And primary graft failure was defined as heart outcomes, death, or retransplantation. And they found only 414 patients with primary graft failure, about 2.5%, with a 90-day mortality of 23%. So, well, then a few years later, well, the ISHLT came to the idea to go in for a consensus guideline, and they first did an pre-Congress online survey to all heart transplant centers in the United States, nearly 10,000 patients, and parameters used for to define primary graft dysfunction was left ventricular ejection fraction less than 40%, or about 80% of the centers used this definition. The time frame in which primary graft dysfunction should be defined within 24 hours was used by about 68% of the centers. And mechanical circulatory support is a mandatory criterion was used in 70% of the centers. So that brought them to have an incidence of about 7% with a 30-day mortality of 30% and a 1-year mortality of 34.6% due to multiple organ failure, graft failure, or sepsis. So the ISHLT defined a consensus definition of primary graft dysfunction, which is a severe ventricular dysfunction of the donor graft, failure to meet the circulatory requirements in the immediate postoperative transplantation period within 24 hours, who need support inotropics, endomechanical circulatory support, and in the absence of secondary causes of graft dysfunction, such as hyperacute rejection, surgical complications, hemorrhagic complications, or pulmonary hypertension. So they defined the severity scale of primary graft dysfunction into mild, moderate, to severe, and they also defined a primary graft dysfunction of the left ventricle with or without the failure of the right ventricle, compared to a primary graft dysfunction of only the right ventricle. So the mild primary graft dysfunction of the left ventricle, one of the following criteria must be met: a left ventricular ejection fraction less than 40%, or hemodynamics with a right atrial pressure more than 15, wedge more than 20, and a cardiac index more than 2 liters, less than 2 liters per minute per square meter, and requiring low doses. So from moderate to severe, you can clearly see that the symptoms were worse, and there was need for intra-aortic balloon pump or other mechanical circulatory support. And for the primary graft dysfunction of the right ventricle, the data were about the same, with a transpulmonary gradient less than 15 and a need for a right ventricular assist device implantation. What about the pathophysiology? Donor-related triggers, surgical, procedural-related triggers, and recipient-related triggers. And as my colleague Dr. Martin already alluded a little bit about this, in the case of brain damage, we will have an increased intracranial pressure due to trauma, subarachnoid hemorrhage, hypoxia leading to edema, inflammation, or space-occupying lesion in the cranium. This causes a catecholamine storm, which causes then myocardial injury. Moreover, patients who are brain dead, they have a loss of spinal cord orthostatic tone, then they will have lower blood pressure with reducing myocardial oxygenation, myocardial perfusion, which also causes myocardial injury. Then there is significant derangement from the pituitary gland, and mannitol might even help or doesn't help, the use of mannitol causes the arrangement of metabolic disturbances, such as hypermagnesemia, or less potassium in the blood. So this all causes myocardial injury. So this is all after donation after brain death. And as my colleague already told us in the previous lecture, what about the donation after circulatory death? Circulatory death causes hypoxemia and hypercarbia of the myocardium, which causes also all kind of injuries on the myocardium. What about then during the surgical or procedure triggers? Well, we have warm and cold ischemia. Warm ischemia is dissecting the heart from the donor. Then cold ischemia is preservation of the myocardial heart, and then bring it to the donation, to the place of the recipient. Then we have the time moment, which causes a cardiomyocyte damage secondary to myocardial restoration of the blood flow, probably due to apoptosis. And then we have the host system adaptive immunity, which causes all kind of myocardial injury and the release of cytokines. So, in summary, exposure to physiological insults, donation of the brain death versus donation of the circulatory death in the donor, hypothermic ischemia during transpo-